So let's look at some of the principles of natural law. Now, in my extended seminar, which goes over a six-week class of lessons, I get into these principles deeply in an extended form. We're not going to do that today because time doesn't allow. I'm going to briefly touch on each one, okay? The word principles, let's define it. Principle comes from the Latin noun principia. Principia means first, foremost, leading, chief, or most necessary. It is that which matters most. It is the first things that must be understood before anything else can be understood. Principles have to come first. And this is the problem. Our society does not put principles first. It puts trivialities first, and we're no longer a society that even cares about principles or first things. So first things first. First things or principles have to come first. So let's look at what the principles that underlie natural law. These are the things that are most important. That's what principles should mean to people. If we ask people to define what a principle is, first thing they should say, that's the most important thing. The most important thing in my life. Now, when in the natural law seminar, we did a homework assignment. We asked people what the most important thing was to them. Very few responded with principles. Most people responded with saying that people, or the family, was the number one response. The familial connection was more important to them than principles. Now, when people hear me say that that's backwards, they'll say, how cold are you? That's so cold, okay? What I'm telling you is that the familial connection, no matter what it is, between a mother and a son, a mother and a daughter, a father and a son, father and a daughter, husband and wife, doesn't matter as much as principles. I'm not telling you they don't matter at all. I'm telling you you have to put principles first. Otherwise, those relationships are just meaningless. They don't really have any real value unless they're based upon principles first, which is why so many relationships are dysfunctional. Principles have to come first before you can even build a solid relationship with another human being. So let's look at what some of the principles of how natural laws work first before we can actually find out what the expressions of these laws are in our lives, which will be the next section. These are what I call the general principles of natural law. Natural law is expressed through seven basic underlying principles, plus what I have referred to as an eighth or hidden principle, which you hear very few other researchers, even people who are studying this from the occult perspective, who are studying this from the consequentialism perspective, you very hear them incorporate the eighth and all-encompassing principle, which I'll get to last here. This eighth principle, which I call the lost principle, binds all the other seven principles together, all right? These principles together constitute a master key through which universal wisdom, including the knowledge of the requirements to obtaining what we desire, is then unveiled or de-occulted. When people ask me, well, what do you consider yourself in your performance of presenting what you present? I tell them, I consider myself a de-occultist. I'm no longer an occultist. I'm a de-occultist. I'm attempting to take this information out of hiding. It's been hidden. The hiding of it is destroying the fabric of our society and putting us into bondage. It needs to come out and be non-hidden. It needs to be unveiled and shared widely and freely with anybody who's capable of accepting it and comprehending it now. Because we're not in a position where we could wait longer. We're at the precipice. Okay, there is a moral obligation to bring this information to the public now. Okay, so I consider myself a de-occultist, one who takes things out of hiding and presents them openly. These are the seven general principles of natural law. Many people who have studied some variants of occultism may recognize these as what are known as the Hermetic principles. Hermetic essentially comes from Hermes. Hermes Trismegistus, the thrice great one, as he was referred to in the ancient Greek mystery traditions. Okay, he was considered a messenger of the gods. He brought the wisdom of the gods down to humanity. Okay, in the ancient Egyptian and Kemetian traditions, he was the scribe of the gods known as Thoth. All right, he has other incarnations as well. But the Hermetic tradition is named such because it's hermetically sealed, like natural law is. Natural law is hermetically sealed. It is binding principles that are immutable. They are laws that are in operation that cannot be changed. Hence, they are hermetically sealed. So these seven general principles, they are mentalism, correspondence, vibration, polarity, rhythm, cause and effect, which is a huge one, which we'll be getting into, and gender. So I'm going to briefly describe what each of these are and what they are about. The principle of mentalism states that the all, everything in creation, is actually a manifestation of mind. The all is mind. Okay, what this means is everything that happens has to be a result of a mental state which preceded it. Everything. For anything to exist, thoughts had to form first, and then they formed the physical reality after. The universe itself is a mental construct of the Creator. Thoughts lead to the manifestation of things and events. Thoughts create conditions. Thoughts create things and conditions. They cannot just magically manifest themselves. Thought comes first. Thoughts create our state of existence and the quality of our experience here on earth, ultimately. Therefore, be responsible for everything. We should be responsible for everything that we create by being responsible for that which we think. Because the thought processes are what are driving the behaviors. People behave the way they do because they have certain belief systems embedded in the mind and running like a program. Their thoughts and their emotions are driving their actions. So the behavior's not magically suddenly going to just change. The thoughts and emotions have to change because they're the driving force behind the behavior. That's when reality will change. See, people don't want to hear that, once again. They don't want to hear, if you want to change reality, you, yourself, have to change the way you think. Because the way you think is not conducive to the requirements for getting what you say you want. They're doing the exact opposite of that in many cases. So that's the principle of mentalism. The principle of correspondence states that that which is above is similar or like to that which is below. So what this means is that which is below, and that which is below is like to that which is above. It's a mirror, okay? The above is like the below is like the above, all right? The above, in this case, is the macrocosm. Okay, the laws of the very large things, okay, the laws that govern the creation, which we consider is seemingly outside of ourselves. We know at the deepest level that it's not, that we're one with it, but, you know, we perceive this as out here, the laws that are govern the large aspects of things. So the macrocosm, or the very large, the totality of everything, and the microcosm, which is the very small, or the individuated units that comprise the whole in their aggregate, okay? They are reflections of each other. They cannot be separated from each other. As one goes, the other goes. The universe is actually a holographic system, okay? It's a hologram is an image, okay? You pass a laser through it, and it then projects a 3D image. Okay, it's like a flat image, and it projects a three-dimensional image. But the aspect, why they call it a hollow, like holistic hologram, holistic image, is if you break a hologram into multiple components by cutting it. So if I take a hologram and I cut it in four pieces, you don't have a quarter of the image on one part of the hologram and a quarter on the other and a quarter on the third and a quarter on the fourth. You have four whole images that only lose their resolution by a quarter, okay? So everything is contained in all the smaller parts, okay? That's like the reality that we're living in. Our universe is a holographic one. So the universe is inside the individual, and the entire universe is like an individual. They're reflections of each other. To know the workings of the individual will help lead us to an understanding of the macrocosmic laws. Similarly, to learn the macrocosmic laws will help us to learn the way that consciousness within the individual functions. These two things cannot be separated from each other. And once again, as I said at the near the beginning, that's what occulted knowledge is. The knowledge of the occult is how the microcosmic world works, which is the individuated consciousness, and how the macrocosmic world works, which is natural law. That's the principle of correspondence. The principle of vibration simply states that there is no such thing as rest, as dead or non-motion, okay? Death, in that sense, is an illusion because true death would be the cessation of all motion and energy. There is no such thing. It doesn't exist. You cannot go anywhere in creation where something is at complete rest, okay? And I joke around about this. Barb tells me funny stories when she comes home from work and she's trying to, you know, enlighten some of the other RNs that she works with. And she was trying to explain to one of the other nurses, you know, that desk has atoms in it and they're not at rest. They're like in crazy chaotic motion, especially the, you know, electron clouds of the atom. And if you look at it at a deep enough level, you would see it's like, you know, chaos going on and it's all kinds of motion happening, seemingly at random. And the other nurse goes, Barb, you're so crazy. You know, what I say to that is, how could you have made it to nursing school and not ever have even considered the concept of the atom? Right. You know, and it's amazing. You know, she actually thinks perceived stillness is actual stillness and didn't comprehend. If you zoom into that with a powerful enough microscope, you're going to see all kinds of motion and nothing's at rest. And she thought Barb was the weird one for trying to explain that to her.
Think about it. The problem with our medicine today, which is very successful, and I'm not here to criticize contemporary scientific medicine, which is extremely successful, but the problem, the limitation of that kind of medicine is that it is a purely physical approach to a physical body. We are trained to think of the human body in purely physical terms and frequently in anatomical terms. We think of a body as a structure. And then we try to figure out the mechanisms of illness, and then we try and interfere with them with the appropriate modality. So we try and figure out how bacteria multiply, and then we interfere with that with an antibiotic. Or we figure out how cancer cells replicate, and we interfere with that with a chemotherapeutic agent. And frequently that works, but as a long-term strategy, it frequently does not work. And that is because mechanisms of illness are not the same thing as origins of illness. Two different things. The origins of illness have to do with understanding the body not as a physical structure, but as a process. Now, the best way I can define that is your body is not a structure, meaning it's not a noun, it's a verb. In fact, there are no nouns in the universe. Nouns are conventions of language. They're not descriptions of reality. Because reality is an activity. Everything is changing all the time. Reality is a flux. Okay? This moment is different from the previous moment. Your body is different from the body that you came into this room with a little while ago. In fact, it's not philosophical. This is a scientific truth. Your physical body, which is made up of atoms and molecules, is constantly recycling, and it recycles through biological processes such as eating, breathing, digestion, metabolism, elimination, but also this whole process is influenced by everything that's happening around us, which means our personal relationships, our social interactions, our emotions, our thoughts, our perception, our environment, the forces of nature and the cosmos, these all influence this physical body. and this physical body is not the same that it was yesterday. It's, as the Greek philosopher Heraclitus once said, the body is like a river. And he's very frequently quoted as saying, you cannot step into the same river twice, because it's a new river and it's a new man or a new human being. You breathe in 10 to the power of 22 atoms from the physical universe. 10 to the power of 22 means 10 followed by 22 zeros. Every time you breathe out 10 to the power of 22 atoms. And these atoms have their origin in every cell of your body. They're coming from all the parts of your body. So at the atomic level, you're breathing out bits and pieces of your heart and kidney and brain tissue. And technically speaking, we are all intimately sharing our organs with each other all the time. So in every moment, our bodies are recycling through each other. We are breathing in each other's atoms. In fact, there's a great quote from Walt Whitman, the American poet. He said, every atom that belongs to you as well belongs to me. You do not own your physical body. You cannot claim ownership of it because it's part of every other body. In fact, we could do some very interesting studies based on mathematical calculations, based on radioactive isotope studies, which could prove without a shadow of doubt that right this moment you have in your physical body at least a million atoms that were once in the body of Jesus Christ or Buddha or Genghis Khan or whoever else you want to think about. In just the last 3 weeks, a quadrillion atoms, quadrillion means 10 followed by 15 zeros, have gone through your body that have gone through the body of every other living species on this planet. So think of a tree in Africa, think of a giraffe in Africa also, think of a peasant in China, think of a taxi driver in Calcutta, and perhaps in Manhattan, and a camel in Saudi Arabia. You have physical stuff this moment in your body that was circulating there 3 weeks ago. In less than 1 year, we recycle 98% of all the atoms in our body. So at the atomic level, you make a new stomach every 5 days, a new skin once a month, a new skeleton every 3 months, a new liver every 6 weeks. At the end of the year, you have recycled almost your entire body down to the last atom. So this physical body that Deepak Chopra is manufacturing this lecture with right now is my year 2012 model. And the last time I came here, I brought the same suitcase but not the same body. My suitcase has a little longer shelf life than my physical body. Then of course it raises the question, if you see, my consciousness has already survived the death of my body many times. I had a body that was once that of a teenager, a body that was once of a baby, now this, tomorrow another one. But my consciousness has already survived the death of my physical body. Right here there's a clue to the conquest of death. Right here, the physical body is dying and the consciousness is surviving. The same feelings, emotions, memories, desires. It's all expressing itself in this physical body, but we cannot confuse the consciousness that we are with the physical body. We ride on this body, but we are not the molecules through which we express ourselves.
Okay, so there is no such thing as true rest. It doesn't exist. If something's in existence, it's in motion. Everything moves, everything vibrates, and at the most fundamental level, the universe and every single thing which comprises it is ultimately pure vibratory energy that is manifesting itself in different ways, different frequencies, different vibratory forms. The universe has no true solidity as such, as we imagine solidity at the macrocosmic level. Matter is merely energy in a state of vibration. And what this is, if we truly understand this, and many sciences are now finally really understanding this and trying to propagate this knowledge out into the public, we will come to the understanding that this is a spiritual construct for experience to be gained, to have an experience and learn and grow in consciousness. That's what the purpose of this whole thing is for, you know? So nothing is truly solid, you know? It's again, like we say, we are spirit having a human experience. The whole universe is spiritual, having a experience in solidity, all right? That's how you have to look at the principle of vibration. Let's look at the principle of rhythm. Everything flows out and in. Everything has its tides. All things rise and fall. Okay, so everything has a rhythm to it or a swing to it. There's tendencies that exist in energy. The pendulum swing manifests in everything that we undergo, everything that we perceive. The measure of the swing to the right is the measure of the swing to the left. It's just an opposite. It's perceived as an opposite. Rhythm will compensate. Now, how this should be understood when we are talking about natural law is many people will say, well, that's just the way the tendency is moving us. It's just the way the tide is taking us, right? But that's not really accurate, okay? We can't look at these things as that the rhythms are set in stone and it has to be this way now, right? One of the things that a lot of the Hermetic tradition taught regarding these laws, these principles, where they can be overcome by higher levels of consciousness. Okay, this one was one of them. Rhythm is a principle that is a tendency for something to swing a certain way. Let's liken it to genetics. You know, if you look at some newer biology, a lot of modern biologists are suggesting consciousness plays into whether a gene activates or not and expresses a certain condition. Well, this is the same way. There's something that can be done about the swing or the tide, okay? Let's look at it as you have a boat. You want to row the boat out to sea, right? You have to get past the tide. You have to get past the breakers and the waves. And if that tide's really strong at high tide, it's going to be very much more difficult. You're going to have to expend more energy to get it out to sea. If, however, you were taking it when the current's moving out to sea, okay, there's a flow that's moving outward deeper into the ocean, and you start rowing that boat then, you're going to be able to do it much more easily, okay? So if there's winds pushing along a plane, it's going to have to expend less energy. It's going to get there more quickly, okay, because it's adding to the energy. If, however, you're flying against the wind, you got to expend a lot more energy. It's just a tendency. You can still get to where you want to go. You may just have to exert more effort. Right now, we're in a tendency of things are not flowing, okay? It's an ebb, all right? And it's something that needs to really have more energy put into it if we're going to resist the tendency. It doesn't mean nothing can be done about it. It doesn't mean it can't be overcome. It means at the time we're living in, okay, we want to make this motion go in this direction, but its tendency is to move in this direction. So more will is required at this time to move the consciousness. At other times, the consciousness may be flowing in a positive direction and it may take much less energy in order to move that consciousness forward. However, we're not living in that time. We are living at what many researchers have called the Kali Yuga, or the age of darkness and destruction. You know, this is the point that resists the flow in consciousness the most. And it's going to take an enormity of effort to break down these pre-existing belief systems that don't serve who we are. So that's the principle of rhythm. This is the principle here in natural law that most fits in with how I'm using the term natural law today, cause and effect. Many people, again, in the New Age community don't want to believe that there's causes and effects, and that effects are driven by causes that, you know, come first and then manifest conditions. So the principle of cause and effect simply states that every cause has its effect and every effect has its cause. Every single thing that occurs happens according to law. All right? Chance is a name for law, a law not recognized. There are many planes of causation, but nothing escapes the law. So again, is there free will? Yes, there is free will. But is there free will to ignore law without consequence? No, there is not. That's the limit of free will. Free will is operating within boundary conditions that I'm referring to as natural law. It's a series of laws, actually. Okay? Free will operates within these parameters or boundary conditions that cannot be exceeded or gone beyond without consequence. Oh, yeah, you can break natural law. Yes, you can break it, but you cannot break it without consequence. You cannot break it without consequence, negative consequence. And that's why this body of knowledge has in the past been referred to as consequentialism. It is the knowledge of how consequences are generated by our free will decision-making processes within the boundaries of natural law. So this is the law of cause and effect, the principle of cause and effect. And I think this image, I was searching for images that encapsulate cause and effect, and I found this cartoon. I think it does it brilliantly. Most of all, because will the effect happen immediately? No, it will not happen immediately. There is a time lag. You set the cause into motion. The universe is going to intelligently bring to you, through a rearrangement of all the dynamics that it needs to rearrange, the effect of what you've generated by setting that cause into motion. And there is a time gap between the cause going into place and the effect coming around and hitting you. This is why the pattern recognition of cause and effect is more difficult, because it is separated by a time lag, by what we perceive as linear time. Now, if you did a wrong to somebody and immediately you were stung by a wasp, every single time you did a wrong to somebody, it showed up and bit you immediately within 2 seconds of you hurting somebody, stealing from somebody, lying to somebody, etc. Would you start to connect the stinging to the wrong that you did? I think most people would see the pattern. They would recognize the pattern. But since that doesn't happen, and there's a time lag to experiencing something harmful to ourselves once we do something harmful to other people, it's very difficult for people to see the connection through the time lag. And moreover, it doesn't exactly happen in a one-to-one ratio like this, okay? It's more, karmic consequence is more complicated than all of that, all right? What's happening is that all of us are experiencing in the aggregate the wrongs that the human species is conducting on a daily basis, which we do not attempt to rectify and stop through our inaction. Karma is being accrued. People think that karma can only be accrued from action. No, it cannot. It can be accrued from inaction as well. And that's where many people in our society is. They're not taking any action, and they're willing to let evil run unchecked.
If thou lend money to any of my people that is poor by thee, thou shalt not be to him as an usurer. Neither shalt thou lay upon him usury. Thou shalt not give him thy money upon usury, nor lend him thy victuals for increase.
The rich ruleth over the poor, and the borrower is servant to the lender.
Karmic consequence is more complicated than all of that. All right? What's happening is that all of us are experiencing in the aggregate the wrongs that the human species is conducting on a daily basis, which we do not attempt to rectify and stop through our inaction. Karma is being accrued. People think that karma can only be accrued from action. No, it cannot. It can be accrued from inaction as well. And that's where many people in our society is. They're not taking any action, and they're willing to let evil run unchecked. So this is ultimately going to come back and bite us, you know? And what we set into motion is going to actually topple over onto us if we don't change our thoughts, emotions, and behaviors. Nothing escapes law. We are bound by it eternally. You know, let me just go back. I'll leave it on this slide for a moment. You know, for some people familiar with my work, you've seen me break down the Matrix trilogy. And the law of cause and effect is brought forward extensively in the second Matrix movie, The Matrix Reloaded. And the scene that encapsulates this the most is the character of the Merovingian, who tells to the heroes who want to be free from the Matrix and its control, okay? You are coming to me without an understanding of why you are in this position. You don't understand the causal factors that have led to the current conditions that are in place. Therefore, you are coming to me with no power to affect change. You are powerless. So why should I help you? You're powerless because you lack knowledge and understanding of what set these events into motion. Why? The question why, he says, why is the only source of real power? Without why, you are powerless. He's talking about cause and effect, and he says it specifically. Causality, he calls the only real truth. And this is the villain. The words of truth come through one of the... It's a big technique in Hollywood, too. The words of truth are spoken by the villain in the movie or in the series. Okay? But if you listen... And there is a twist, a dark twist to what he says. He says free will is like an illusion. No, it is not. That's where the dark occultist is trying to trip up the heroes. There are both free will and natural law. He tries to say free will. The Morpheus character says to him, everything starts with choice. And Morpheus is correct. Our choices set that causality into motion before it becomes an effect. And the Merovingian tries to tell him, no, there is no free will. That's where the dark occultist will give you the bulk of truth and then poison it with that one thing he wants to get you to accept, okay?
Which actually leads us to another big topic that you bring up, is that of choice and free will. And one of the really, really powerful ideas that I love that you brought up in the book is the more strongly that we identify with something, and as an example for our viewers, think of your titles, think of your jobs, think of your belief systems, religions, ideas, anything, the less choice or free will that we have. Can you talk a little bit about the aspect of free will?
Free will is an extremely difficult topic, right? Mm-hmm. Because our intuition about free will is that it isn't determined. Because if it is determined by some process, it's not free.
Yeah.
But it also isn't random. Because if it is random, it's not will. I will certain things. They're not random. I have preferences. They're not random. It's not the throw of a dice. In a sense, they are determined. But hey, if they are determined, they are not free. So you see, there is no semantic space for our intuition of free will if we insist in making it different from determinism on the one hand and randomness and meaninglessness on the other. There is no space in between these two. So what is the intuition actually telling us? I think what the intuition tells us is that true free will is when a choice is determined by ourselves. It is determined. It's not random. It's not a throw of the dice. But it's determined by that which we identify ourselves with. Nobody identify themselves with electrochemical processes in their brains. They identify themselves with their subjective inner life. Mm-hmm. So as long as the choice is made by their subjective inner life, determined by that, by their psychological archetypes, their previous experiences, their memories, predispositions, and so on, it is free will. Now, notice how I defined it. Free will is when the choice of an agent is determined by that which the agent identifies itself with. So free will is determined by identification. What do you identify yourself with? If you identify yourself with your ego, then the rest of your psyche is determining what you feel. You have no free will. You're unconscious, that handy clinical definition. Mm-hmm. Your unconscious is determining your neuroses, your compulsions, your depression, everything. What free will do you have? It determines even your choices of your partner by unconscious projection. You have no free will if you identify with your ego. Maybe you can choose what's the best health insurance or the best route to work, but it's extremely limited. Now, if you bring the unconscious into awareness through practicing conscious living, which is a term you like to use, if you identify yourself with the very ground of existence, which is awareness itself, the thing that underlies everything that is or can be, your free will is unlimited.
Yeah.
Because free will is determined by identification.
Yeah,
that's my position, at least.
I really, really, really like that explanation. And I think it says so much also about, you know, even if we look at other philosophies and spiritual disciplines, even from Buddhism and such, you know, the aspect of attachment is our downfall in so many different areas. And so if we start to see this connection between, you know, how do I think I have a choice in life? How big is my field of choice? And what my attachments are, it's incredible what, you know, processes start to open up for us and then start to open up our choice field.
There is something about yourself that you don't know. Something that you will deny even exists until it's too late to do anything about it. It's the only reason you get up in the morning. The only reason you suffer the shitty boss, the blood, the sweat, and the tears. This is because you want people to know how good, attractive, generous, funny, wild, and clever you really are. Fear or revere me, but please think I'm special. We share an addiction. We're approval junkies. We're all in it for the slap on the back. And the gold watch. The hip hip who fucking raw. Look at the clever boy with the badge, polishing his trophy. Shine on, you crazy diamond. Because we're just monkeys, wrapped in suits, begging for the approval of others. If we knew this, we wouldn't do this. Someone is hiding it from us. And if you had a second chance, you would ask why.
Free will is when the choice of an agent is determined by that which the agent identifies itself with. So free will is determined by identification. What do you identify yourself with? If you identify yourself with your ego, then the rest of your psyche is determining what you feel. You have no free will. Your unconscious, that handy clinical definition, mm-hmm. Your unconscious is determining your neuroses, your compulsions, your depression, everything. What free will do you have? It determines even your choices of your partner by unconscious projection. You have no free will if you identify with your ego. Maybe you can choose what's the best health insurance or the best route to work, but it's extremely limited. Now, if you bring the unconscious into awareness through practicing conscious living, which is a term you like to use, if you identify yourself with the very ground of existence, which is awareness itself, the thing that underlies everything that is or can be, your free will is unlimited.
Yeah.
Because free will is determined by identification.
If you change the rules on what controls you,
you will change the rules on what you can control.
So the next thing that needs to be understood is the two planes. All right, there's the plane of effects, and then there's the plane of causes. No power to affect any change lies on the plane of effects, which is the physical manifested reality. Again, what already is, nothing can be done about. What already is, you cannot change. You cannot change the past. You can change what it is starting now and make sure that it gets changed in the future. But right now, what is the truth, and all you can do is accept that or reject it. You can't change the past. So the physical world that is manifested up to this point happened because of things that occurred in the past. The causes happened in the past. Nothing you can do about that right now. Okay? The plane of effects or the physical world is where manifested realities have already occurred, have already taken shape, have already formed due to their underlying causal factors. The plane of effects constitutes that which has already occurred. As such, no power to affect change lies here because that which has already occurred cannot unoccur. That which has occurred can't undo itself. It happened. It's already done. It has become that which is, or truth. Human consciousness seems to be trapped upon the plane of effects, meaning that humanity as a whole remains ignorant of the underlying causes which they themselves have set into motion and which lead to self-inflicted suffering in their lives. So if you're trapped at this level, what you're doing is you're looking at the symptoms, and you're stuck looking at the symptoms. Okay? This is everybody. Oh, there's a political solution to this. We need to vote in the right people. Oh, there's a financial solution to this. We just need to set the right monetary policy. No, there's a scientific solution to this. And technological advancements are going to be made that suddenly save ourselves and make the world any different. And they think all of this is going to be done while slavery is still in place. Well, again, good luck with that. Let me know how it works out. Okay? I speak at free energy related events. I work with the Tesla Science Foundation. I speak at MUFON-related events to talk about disclosure of extraterrestrial presence, okay? Both of these communities don't understand. The things that they say they want are impossible. And I'm going to start talking about them in this way more openly, you know, because I've kind of like given them some soft teachings, and I think they need to hear it a little bit more harshly, because both of these communities are not talking about morality to the extent that they need to. They think we're going to have free energy, but nothing's going to change as far as the social structure of the world goes. We'll just develop free energy and that'll magically save us. We'll still have slavery, but free energy will be here and the world will be a magically better place. The UFO community, they often think, oh, we're going to get disclosure. They're going to come out and tell us everything we know about other intelligences that are out there in the galaxy and in the universe with us. Okay? And they think they're going to get that in a climate of slavery. Well, good luck with all those things. You got to take down the existing structure first, okay? People think, oh, we got to build the new world while the old one decays. You have to destroy the existing power structure with the power of truth before anything new is going to grow here. Because this place is a garden full of weeds, of poisoned ideologies and completely erroneous belief systems that have no bearing on truth whatsoever and cannot get us what we say we want. Until that those thoughts are changed, don't expect the results you want. So to the free energy movement, I say you're never going to get free energy in a climate of slavery. To the UFO community, I say you will never get disclosure in a climate of slavery. Slavery has to end first. Then you could get what you say you want. So, again, no power to affect any change lies in the world of effects. Cannot be done. You are rearranging the deck chairs on the Titanic while it sinks. You're not creating any change doing those things because the underlying causes aren't changing. And the underlying causes are how we think, how we feel, and how we behave. And no one wants to look at that. They want to think all those things can stay in place and I can magically get what I want. I want to keep my hand over the fire, but I don't want it to burn and blister. Well, enjoy. See, find out what you get when you do that, because that's what we're doing when it comes to natural law. See, the Greek noun logos, which is written there in Greek script, which means word in Greek, it comes from the Greek verb lego, all right? Lego in Greek means to speak or to say. It's where we get the English word lexicon from, all right? The Latin noun lex, legis, is related to the Greek verb lego to say. Again, because who put the laws into manifestation? The Creator did. How did the Creator manifest the physical universe and all the laws? Spoke it into existence. Reality and truth are spoken into existence by the power of vibration, the vibratory power of voice. Okay? So the Creator created the universe by the phrase, fiat lux in Latin. It means let there be light. Okay? The Latin noun lex legis, meaning law, is actually derived from this Greek verb lego, meaning to speak or to say. God, and not man, is the logos, the author of law, the one who spoke the law into existence at the creation of the universe, because natural law is the boundary conditions of the manifested reality called the physical universe. These are the boundary conditions which govern it. Humanity's work is to learn to listen to God's word, not man's law, natural law, spiritual law, moral law, God's law, karmic law. I don't care what you want to call it. Call it whatever you want. Okay? Consequentialism. This is the truth. That's what you want to talk about, what all these phrases really mean. It all comes back to the word truth. That's it. It's the truth about what is, what's operating here. And humanity needs to align its behavior to this law, God's law, natural law. Without alignment of its behavior, don't expect to natural law, don't expect a thing to change here. Expect it to rapidly grow worse. Humanity must make a cosmic apology by giving the word, okay, which means the authorship of creating law. See, we think we're the authors, we're the authorities. That's what author means, right? Author. What's another word for author? This is just this is how mind control through words works, right? An author is a what? A writer. Well, what are you saying there? An author who has authority, they are authoring something, is a writer. They are a write, R-I-G-H-T-E-R. Okay? They're making it into a right. This is what you hear when you hear the word authority. You hear author, which means a writer, meaning one who makes rights, which means someone who believes they're God. That's all this really comes down to. In a nutshell, we're up against a class of people who believe that they can be God and own and rule everybody else. That's all the dark occult comes down to, folks. People who believe they're God. Sick, psychopathic lunatics who think they're God and are going to rule the hell of the prison world that they're going to create, that they call their dark new world order. We need to give the word back. That's what an apology is. And who it needs to be given back to is the creator of the universe, because that's the author of the law. That's its rightful owner. The word doesn't belong to us, folks. The word belongs to God. That's why it says at the beginning of the biblical text, in the beginning was the word, and the word was God. You know, that's what the logos is. Natural law. God is law. You want the best definition I could ever give you for the word God? Law. People don't want to look at it like that. Very few people ever look at it like that. That's what the force of creation is. It's natural law. It's how we create, co-create our reality, whether we do it consciously or unconsciously. So let's look at the plane of causality. This is the other plane. This is the mental realm, the mental world. Again, according to the law of mentalism, the first principle of natural law, everything that manifests must first manifest in mind before it can manifest physically. So again, if the plane of causality is the mental world, that's generating the causes in mind, okay? Everything is happening there first, and then it is trickling down to the physical domain. It is manifesting in the physical domain only after it has manifested in the mental world. The plane of causality is where causes are set into motion prior to those causes manifesting as formed realities in the plane of effects. This plane of causality constitutes the causal factors, the why, which underlies and precedes all manifested things and events. All power to effect change lies on this plane of reality. Human consciousness must move away from the plane of effects and to the plane of causality in order for human beings to understand the causal factors of the conditions which they are collectively manifesting in their lives. Only then will humanity be able to co-create their shared reality on a conscious level, meaning with an understanding of how natural law operates, rather than on an unconscious level, meaning that we don't understand how natural law operates. And I just look at it in a simple graphic, in a simple, you know, chart or graph. This is the higher realm. This is the world of causality, the mental world, the why, the underlying causal factors, okay, that precede conditions which are manifested. This is where our consciousness has to go, because this is where all power to effect change is at, in the understanding of why that manifested to begin with. So these are the symptoms. This line could be looked at as the diagnosis. You have to make that diagnosis and get to the underlying causal factors that lead to the symptoms. Okay? The plane of effects, on the other hand, meaning the physical world, is the manifested realm, that which has already occurred, that cannot be undone. At least in the present moment, you could start in the present to undo it in the future. But as far as the present moment and all moments in the past go, you're not changing that. That's truth. That's what is. Okay? That's already manifested. You can't change it. No power to affect change lies in continuously analyzing the symptoms. You got to do that long enough that you know where the problem's at. You've made the diagnosis. Now you can get to the causal factors and start going to work changing those causes. Okay? Unfortunately, this plane, the plane of effect, seems to be where human consciousness in the aggregate is trapped. It can't seem to get past there. Even if it recognizes the problem, it wants to keep describing the problem. It wants to keep describing the prison. It doesn't want to look at the causal factors because it's afraid of what the causal factors are. It doesn't want to acknowledge the causal factors lie in how we think, feel, and act. And until those things are changed, the external manifestation cannot change. That takes responsibility. The final principle of the seven principles of natural law, at least the formalized ones, are gender. Again, I'm going to talk about an eighth lost one. Gender exists in everything. Everything has its masculine and its feminine components or principles. We've already seen that when it comes to the human brain, consciousness, worldview, etc. Gender manifests on all planes of existence, spiritual, mental, physical, everything. Okay? Very simple concept. What I want to briefly talk about is mental gender. Mental gender is the state of coexistence between the masculine and feminine aspects of the mind. Again, we've already looked at this. We looked at the breakdown of the physiology of the brain, at least of the higher order part of the brain, the neocortex. Our left brain hemisphere largely facilitates the masculine aspects of the mind, or the intellect, logic, analytical thought, linear thought processes, while the right brain hemisphere largely facilitates the feminine aspect, or intuition, meaning creativity, compassion, and holistic thought processes. This next section is what I call the lost principle. This is the eighth principle of natural law, which binds all of the other principles together. Okay? It is what I would call the encapsulating principle. Okay? It's the container inside which all the other principles fit very nicely and neatly. However, it's lost because we're not exercising it. See, we already looked at 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 principles of natural law. And there they are represented by these circles overlapping each other. Okay? Can anybody see an eighth circle anywhere? You got it. Correct. Here's the eighth circle. And this might look familiar. You might have seen this somewhere. Okay? This pattern is called something. Does anybody know what this pattern is called? What is it? Not the flower of life. The seed of life. The seed of life. Okay? Now, what happens from a seed? It grows. It generates something. It creates something. A seed has an outer casing, an outer shell. Okay? Then if you're going to get to the inner core of it that contains all of the creative, genetic, generative material, okay, that shell has to be there and intact. You break the shell of the seed, the creative essence of the seed is going to be gone. Okay? Now, what is that principle? Here's what that principle is. It's the eighth, or what I call the lost principle. And it's the thing that has to be present in order for any change to manifest itself. And it is not what most people think of it as. Even when I tell you what this is, I guarantee you there will be an inaccurate connotative meaning for what people think this means. Okay? Here's what the eighth principle is. It is known as the generative principle, or the principle which governs creation, which actually is the causal factor that goes into effect and generates the result that we say that we want. But what's the real term for it? Who can guess what the actual term, what the generative principle of creation actually is? No, it is not action. It, okay, now most people will say it's love. I want to distinguish it from the concept of love, even as I'm going to describe love in this presentation a little bit later on. Okay, what is it?
Procreation.
No? What? Somebody said it. But somebody said something else. No?
Care.
Who?
Care.
Care. There it is. Okay? The generative principle is care. Now, this is different than compassion. People say, why don't you use the word compassion? Because that's not what I'm talking about. It is a different concept than compassion, or even what I would describe as love. Care, and I mean care with a capital C, and here I didn't even put it with a capital C. I'm just putting it in all uppercase care. Distinguish this from care with a lowercase c, okay? This means, what are you giving attention and helping to grow? What are you focusing upon? Because what focus you're focusing upon, that's what's ultimately getting generated, getting created, and growing. And this doesn't mean be ignorant of what's going on in the world and don't look at anything that's negative because you're going to feed that and give power to it. That's not what it means. Okay? That means you know what you're feeding? In that instance, if you want to do that, you're feeding ignorance. And that's what's going to grow. It's the exact opposite that the New Agers want you to believe that it is. By ignoring the negative, you are ensuring that more of it occurs. You are fueling it by ignorance, ensuring that it grows and takes over. Okay? What care has to be looked at here as is, this is what you're giving your energy to. This is what you're focused upon. This is what you actually care enough about to do, to spend your time on, to put your attention on, to manifest in the world. That's what I'm talking about as care, okay? That's what generates our experience in the aggregate. Most people don't care about what's really happening. Therefore, it is an impossibility for us in the aggregate to change the direction of energy, to change the direction of consciousness, and ultimately to get what we say we want. That's how the real law of attraction works, all right? Here's how it actually operates. The lost principle is the dynamic of care. What we care about on a day-to-day basis acts as the driving force of our thoughts and actions. What did I say we need to develop? The heart, mind, guts, right? Heart, mind, guts, in that order. Care comes first. You got to care enough to know, to develop the knowledge. Okay, then you got to act on it and put it into practice, apply it. So that's the order, heart, mind, guts, care, knowledge, action. Those are the steps, okay? And all three of those have to be in place. All three. That's what unity consciousness is. It's unifying thoughts, emotions, and actions. The three aspects of consciousness, such that there is no contradiction between them. Our thoughts, what we say, what we think, how we feel, and how we act are one and the same. There's no contradiction. That's unity consciousness. Okay? Therefore, okay, since it's the care is the driver of our thoughts and actions, it ultimately can be seen as the generator of the quality of our shared experience here on the earth. Care is what generates the whole thing. Hence, it has been called the generative principle. Liken the heart to a pump in the body. Well, what does a pump do? It's a generator. It provides energy. It moves the life force through the blood in the body. In every ancient tradition, they talk about the life force being in the blood. The heart is what pumps that through the whole physiology and enables us to continue to sustain life. Okay? The heart is the generator. It's the pump. It's the center of the being. As important as the brain is, which we just talked about the importance of it, the heart is ultimately what's generating the experience. Because what we care about determines what we think about on a daily basis most of the time, and therefore how we behave. All right? So, this principle has often been referred to as the generative principle. Is anybody familiar with the compasses and square symbol of Freemasonry? With the G in the middle? Well, that's what the G stands for at the highest level. They'll talk about many, many porch Masons. These are the exoteric Masons that are given the teachings of the profane and they think they're in the know, okay? They're given the information, well, this only means geometry, it only means God, etc., okay? One of the things they'll tell you it means at a slightly higher level is that it means gnosis, knowledge, okay, which we saw the meaning of in Greek earlier. At a higher level, at illuminated levels of Freemasonry, which are above 32nd degree, they will give you what the real meaning of the G inside the compasses and square is, and it is the generative principle. It means genesis, creation, okay? And yeah, you can tie that right back to God. I'm not saying those things are different. And the forms that get created in the physical manifested world are geometric forms. So it is geometry as well. It's all these things. But at the highest level, it's the generative principle. That's what that G really stands for in esoteric Freemasonry. Okay? It's called the generative principle because that means to create. It comes from, the word generative comes from Latin, the verb genere, as we've already talked about, means to create. The generative principle is what we create through. And it's lost because people don't care. They don't have care. Hence, it's the lost principle. Okay? Here's how it works, folks. What we care enough to put our will behind. Okay? So again, heart, mind, guts. Guts is the will. The action, the masculine principle. That's what gets things done ultimately in the physical domain. What we care enough to put our will behind. And that's driven by the care. That's the generator or the pump that drives the will. Okay? What we care enough to put our will behind is ultimately what gets created or manifested in our world. The world is the way that it is because most people do not care enough, even if they say, they pay lip service, okay, and say that they want things to be different. They don't care enough to actually change it through their actions. Because when it, again, when it comes all down to it, and I said this in my New Age, BS seminar or lecture, okay? What it comes down to is preventing action. Preventing action. That's what the New Age community is designed to do. They want people inactive because the dark occultists know that the thing that is ultimately generating our reality is behavior, as you saw in that simple four-part chart, that little building block chart that I put up there. Action is what's generating the reality. That gets generated through what we care about because our cares and our desires drive our actions. Okay? So Most people will say they want things to change, but then when you say, what are you doing to make that change happen? Not a word. Silence comes back on the other end. Okay? So, they don't care enough to change it through their actions. That's what the generative or lost principle is about. And until that principle is regained, and people get out of their laziness, and most of all, get out of their cowardice. Again, in that New Age lecture, I'm talking about what it ultimately comes down to in the New Age movement, and I'll look at any New Ager in the eyes. They're cowards. Cowards. Ultimately, they know the evil that we're up against, and they intend to do not a damn thing about it. That's what it really comes down to. And anybody telling you it's different than that is lying to you. Okay? They're cowards. Period. And I'll say it right to any of their faces. Anything I say up here, anybody that believes in that nonsense, come and bring them to me. I'll tell them right to their face. Straight and open, just like I said it here. Because I don't care. I don't care about their nonsense. I care about what's real. Okay? So, I'm telling you, this religion has to go. It's got to go. If people are going to make real change happen, the idea that it can't be done, that it can be done without taking actual real-world action has to be purged from human consciousness. Reality does not work like that. Period. The end. I can't make you accept that. I recognize I can't make anybody in this room accept that. All I can do is put it out there for your consideration, and if you have some common sense and really, really think about it, you'll understand what I'm saying here is absolutely the way it is. Okay? Many people want to deceive you through these religious notions, okay, which is all about getting people to stand down and accept their chains. That's what that religion's in place for. These principles together constitute a master key, through which universal wisdom, including the knowledge of the requirements to obtaining what we desire, is then unveiled or de-occulted. I'm attempting to take this information out of hiding. It's been hidden. The hiding of it is destroying the fabric of our society and putting us into bondage. It needs to come out and be non-hidden. Needs to be unveiled and shared widely and freely with anybody who's capable of accepting it and comprehending it now. Because we're not in a position where we could wait longer. We're at the precipice, okay? There is a moral obligation to bring this information to the public now.